Boss Man Show, friend of the show, Coach Bob Richey, Furman Paladins here with me. Coach, how things up there in Greenville, man?
All good, all good. Just, in the middle of the holiday season, we got exams kicking off our guys today. So, you know, that's this time of year, that's always important as you navigate also all the basketball activity that we have. So it's, a lot of things going on, but definitely more good than bad. We got, we're early in our season, almost a third of the way through. And, we've got some exciting wins. We've got a couple close losses that, are really going to help us down the stretch as we continue to, develop this team, but really, really like our group and, like our potential.
I'll ask you about that. You know, even though you lost at Belmont, lost to Winthrop, there was tough games, back and forth games that helped you down the road, was executing in the clutch. So really for me, it's better it happened in November, December than it happens in February and March when it really counts. So how are you going to use these opportunities to teach your guys going forward about late game situations, using in practice maybe, to get them ready for these situations when they happen again in live action?
Yeah, I mean, we've been in five really close games, four overtime games, and then last night was a one possession game, and we've won three and we've lost two, and I think just continuing to build confidence in that. And really when you look at it, basically, I guess if you four of the five have been on the road. And so I think that's a positive as well, is just really learning how to play on the road and then really learning how to think through those tough situations on the road. You know, I think for us, some people have said that we've got an old team, which is about the furthest thing from the truth. We've got some old guys at the top of our lineup, but 5 through 10 for us, so 6 of the 10 guys that we've played are either freshmen or COVID freshmen. And so we're being able, having some time to groom those guys, get those guys some experience. I mean, Belmont's more than likely going to win the OVC. Winthrop's more than likely going to win the Big South. I mean, you're getting some big time experience. And then you go and you win at Louisville in overtime. We beat College of Charleston in overtime here. High Point, we were down late, came back, won that in overtime. So, I think all that stuff's going to pay off. And, we made a decision this year to really, ramp the schedule up a little bit. And, we're only playing 1-9-1. We've gone on the road as much as anybody in the country so far. And, I think all that stuff, right, it's about finding your best in March. And we've had fun Novembers around here. We've been undefeated around here in November before. But, we hadn't been able to get it done in Asheville yet. And that's the last checkoff for what we're trying to do here, is to go in Asheville. And so we're just trying to play the long game. You got to win the war, not the battle. And I think we've got to continue to figure out how to, mesh this team, develop this team, grow this team. But so far early, offensively, we're a little bit ahead defensively. We've got one of the top offenses in the country right now statistically, but defensively, we got to find a little bit more consistency. And I think some of these hard competitive games are going to reveal that to us.
Like you mentioned, you have 6 freshmen, either COVID freshmen or real freshmen. Defense is always the hardest thing for those guys, learning your schemes, your concepts, knowing the checks and calls when something happens, whether it's you need to stagger it, you need to hard hedge it or whatever you need to do. So that part for young guys is always the hardest part of the equation, because in high school, you can just show up with talent and you can do what you want to. But at D1 level, you got to learn how to film sessions, schemes, learn the calls, learn what you got to do, learning scouting reports as well, because I feel like that's for young guys. For me, I was talking to these young guys. I was been harsh and they tell me they have trouble with is getting the game plan discipline, learning about defenses and how to really prepare for every game. I guess your last.
Yeah, it's really just developing that defensive urgency and that defensive desire. Most high school players, let's just call it what it is, right? I mean, it's not really the thing they desire the most. You're getting them. And the game to a young player is still, how many points did I score? And, really developing that competitive excellence to where they can play, really complete on both sides of the floor and with the type of urgency that they've got to play on that end of the floor. And, the smallest of mistakes can just kill possessions. And that's what makes defense so hard at this level, is offenses are so good. And now people are playing in so much space that your precision and your detail and your urgency has to be so, so good that if you're just operating in that, compliant level, if you're just operating in that, hey, I want to make sure my guy's good, you can get yourself in some trouble. And, you know, we've got some growth that we got to do there. And, you know, it's not that we're bad defensively. I don't think we're going to beat the Louisville's and the College of Charleston's if we're bad defensively, but I think we've got it. It's that good to great type deal, you know, that good's the enemy of great. And if we want to have a chance to cut the nets down in a league that's this good, that's this talented. I was looking at the nets yesterday for the Southern Conference, and every single team in our league besides one is inside the top 200 in the net. And I think we had two teams in the top 100, and then we had like seven teams from 100 to 200, which at this level was really rare. I mean, you know, and I think our lowest ranked team was like 227. So we had no teams past that. And so our league's going to be ultra competitive for a mid-major conference. And, you know, we just got to continue improving and finding those improvement points. And that's what playing a tough schedule does, right? Like, you could play lesser competition, and, you know, you could play more home games, and, you know, you look at, you know, what some of these people have the luxury to do. You know, it's one of those situations where, you know, you're at home and you're a little bit more isolated, insulated, and you don't know all the things that you got to, you know, really get better at. And which for us, I mean, it's pretty clear, like, here's what we do really well. Here's the things that we got to continue to improve in. And now we just got to go do the work.
Now, I personally watched UNCG live this year, Mercer live twice here. It's Kennesaw and a Georgia State on Saturday. I saw Chattanooga live. So, oh, wow. I know how hard your league is. I've watched it just myself watching it live. Like, man, it's going to be a tough dog fight every night. I don't care who you are in this other conference. Anybody can get beat any day of the week. And I was like, you all do a great job. And I feel like the mid-major world should boost you up more, because the basketball is so kind. It's very hard, but it's well coached. And you can't have it easy. Now, even you can't say, oh, this is a win. Nobody can say in this league ever.
No, it's going to be 18 games that you have to show up every single night. And, you know, there's a lot of good programs. There's a lot of consistency of culture. And, you know, it's one of those situations where this league is, you know, elevated each and every year to where now these programs have gotten confidence, and, you know, the league's gotten confidence, and people are operating and acting in a way that we think we're one of the better mid-major leagues in the country. And, you know, that's great. You know, I think that people are starting to take notice. I think when you look at the high major wins that the league's been able to produce, you know, I think five teams in the league have gotten a Power Five win, if I'm not mistaken. And, you know, that's half our conference. And so, you know, you look at what's going on in the league, and it really, I mean, the conversation to eventually get multiple teams in the tournament. I mean, I think the league's starting to really show that there can be potential there. I mean, I think Chad's net right now is like in the top 30. And, you know, so it's one of those situations where this is going to be a grind. This is going to be a marathon. And, you know, you can't get discouraged. You can't get defeated. You can't let one game define you. You just got to keep developing, and you got to keep improving. You got to keep getting better. And, you know, I think the teams that stay the most excited to improve, right? I mean, just the ones that can handle the ebbs and flows of the season and, you know, not overreact. You know, you got to make sure you count your blessings. I mean, we were down six other night with 24 seconds to go versus Charleston and somehow found a way to win. And then last night we're up two late and didn't get a loose ball and Winthrop did, and they hit a three and they go up and the crowd gets into it and they score the last 7 points of the game and, you know, finish us on a 7-0 run and beat us. But, you know, it all balances out. And regardless of what's going on this early season, you've got to be able to figure out, okay, this is what we're good at, and this is what we need to go get better at so that we can prepare for what's going to be a really, really good conference play.
And Jalen, your guy Jalen triple-double last night, first in school history. Tell me about that, man. I know we should make more of those shots he took, but, hey, triple-triple-double still good on the road there at Winthrop, man.
Yeah, I mean, he's just really coming into his own. And really, to be honest with you, I keep telling him every day, I mean, he's got the ability to play at the next level for a long time. He really does. I mean, there's no doubt in my mind. It's just going to come down to, you know, him continuing to improve, you know, finding consistency on both ends of the floor. But his ability to dribble, pass, shoot, rebound the ball, run the floor, play different spots on the floor. You know, he's really extended his range. I mean, there's really not a whole lot he can't do on the court. It's just now, okay, can we continue to have the type of urgency and the consistency in that? But, you know, the game before, he had 33 and 13. And so, you know, he's just got, you can run offense through him. You know, yeah, I mean, obviously he's going to want a couple of those layups back last night, you know, some of those shots around the basket. But, you know, just to ask it, I mean, we couldn't ask him to do much more. I mean, we were plus six when he was on the court. And so, you know, he definitely gave, you know, everything he had to the game. And, you know, he's got this year, and he's also got his COVID year next year. So he's got some time to continue to improve. And, but I couldn't be more pleased of what he's been able to do. I mean, he's really exciting player to watch right now.
Most definitely, man. You know, I'm thinking to myself, man, that guy took a difference for you. Like, on a night it was not going for you guys, don't give that guy the ball, man, and he gets everybody excited and going. That's what you want. Like, I know for the Hawks, it's John Collins. The people like it's Trae Young, but when Jason gets a dunk for the Hawks, it gets everybody going. It gets everybody energized. So, I think Jalen has that same impact on your team as well. When he gets going, everybody falls right behind him.
That's right. I mean, he's also got that, you know, charisma to him. He's got that energy and presence about him, you know, that makes him fun to play with. And, you know, Mike Bothwell's another one that's got great energy to him. And then Alex Hunter's our fifth year senior guard that's, you know, been leading us in scoring, actually. And so we've got three all conference players and those three guys, and, you know, they've really had a good start to the season. And I could see it was coming with how all three of them worked this offseason. And, you know, so it's like I said, there's a lot of things to be excited about with our group. You know, how good we are right now, how much better we can get. And you know, that's what you gotta have, right? You don't wanna be sitting here December 8th feeling like you're hitting your head on the ceiling. Like, you wanna be able to see signs of growth and where we can improve. And so, you know, we're excited about what's ahead. And you know, we know that we've got some really good players, and we've got a good team, but we also got to go get better.
And you got some facilities coming too. It's better. $3 million facilities, man. Tell me about that, man. How's it going to impact the players being who you have now, being called to Boston recruiting-wise? The show guys, the great facilities in Greenville there, man. A great season up I-85 there. So tell me about that. It's going to help your program recruit this program facility even more, man.
Yeah, I mean, it's you know, it's been much needed. We're a little bit behind in terms of the facilities in our league, and you know, you've got to make sure that we get these up to par. And so our administration has done a good job of getting the ball rolling, and they got us into a brand new office complex, which is really, really nice. We've got a brand new film room coming. We've got a new locker room that we'll move into here in the next couple of weeks, and all that stuff. I mean, it's really done well. I mean, they didn't cut any corners on that stuff, and it's going to make the working and the living areas and the learning areas of the facility really as good as it can be. And then, you know, the next phase is to move into the arena, and, you know, they're working on the timetable, what that's going to look like, and, you know, just renovating the whole space. And you know, it's you know how it is in college sports right now. Like, you can't have a top third expectation with bottom third facilities. You know, you gotta make sure that, you know, you have the facilities that are able to attract the best recruits in the country at your level. And when recruits come on campus, they're looking to see commitment, and they want to see how much it matters. And when you show them facilities that are improving, and you show them facilities that are becoming more complete, then what you're saying is, it's a tangible way to say, hey, this matters. And, you know, when they walk on campus, you know, and they see facilities that aren't comparable to what they're seeing at some other places they're going to, then internally they're going to question that commitment. And, you know, so it's been fun to see our institution really say, hey, look, this is, we know we got to do this. Let's go get this done. And, to make the incremental progress, and to really get it going in the right direction so that we can attract the best recruits in the country at our level.
And I think it'll help with the portal too. I know with the portal, man, it's a whole nother world. You got the COVID year with the guys in around, but the portal is crazy too. So do you leave a spot open for a guy that may be a right fit for you all going forward to help you in case you want to fill a gap there, or you just want to probably just develop the six guys you have now and mixing around those guys with new recruits coming in?
Yeah, you know, I mean, we've built this thing on doing it different, and we're going to continue to be different. And I don't think the portal is going to be sustainable for everybody. I think just, you know, simple supply and demand from a business standpoint, you know, like it's not going to be able to create winners in terms of everybody can't win in the portal. You know, like if everybody goes to the portal, like it's not some, you know, magic, you know, hey, you know what, here's going to be the answer for everybody. I think development is still going to be the best route for all of us. And I think in a couple of years, that's going to prove out that there's no quick fixes in this, you know? And I think that the portal for us, the way we're going to utilize the portal is we don't want to build our recruiting philosophy on it, because we want to continue to always be a developmental program. That's how this thing was 7 years ago. This was 342 in the RPI. Okay. Like Furman was not in a good, it was not in a good spot. And the holistic development has created a different niche for us that has put us in a position where we can have sustainable success. You know, we lose two all conference players last year, Noah Gurley and Clay Mounts, and everybody's like, well, they're going to take a step back. And, you know, we've been able to develop and we've been able to have the next man ready. But where the portal is going to come into play for us is if we do lose one, which is inevitable in this world right now, because we've made it cool to quit. You know, we've made it cool. Like, it's like literally like, this is exciting, right? Like to go into the portal, and we've just made it acceptable and cool to just, hey, if it's not working for you, just, you know, if you're looking for greener grass, and just go do it, you know? And like, we've made this thing like a commonality. And so, you know, I think you're going to lose one. You got to fight for retention. But when we do, we're going to look to be able to replace it so that we can stay old. Right. And that's what we did with this group. Like when Noah Gurley left to go to Alabama, then we utilized the portal to find Conley Garrison. That was a very, very good Division II player that's starting for us right now. And is a really good player for us. And with that though, we still had our checkoffs of this is the type of people that we want in our program. And we were very intentional to make sure that was the case before bringing him in, because, you know, I mean, it's just, I think you gotta be careful. I really do. And, you know, so we're gonna make sure that it's, you know, it's right for our program. It's right for our fit, but we just signed two really good high school players. I mean, I think that, you know, the high school market is going to be a little bit less attractive because people are going to be sitting in this portal. And so I think there's going to be opportunity to get a better high school kid. But we've got to make sure that then we go retain them, because, you know, unfortunately there's a lot of pre-portal work going on in our business right now. And, you know, you're going to have to recruit your players every single day.
Most definitely. The only thing I said about the portal coach is I told my father, if Georgia State had football, I would love to hit TSU. Tennessee State came to Atlanta. The only thing I would have did is come home in Atlanta playing in the dome, because that's where they play their home games. They first started football. So Georgia State started football my senior year. Since it was the portal, I would have came back home to Atlanta, played in Georgia Dome, with the Falcons playing. That's why I was using it for that only. But
no doubt, man.
Yeah, man. But I'll tell you, it's a whole new world. I'm glad that when I was playing 05 to 08, it wasn't like this. Thank God, because go somewhere for 4 years, know I'm going to be there. And it was what it was. But I know what you mean, man. I know the headaches you have every day. Having to make sure you keep your guys on point, staying there with you, man. But you had a big game Friday night against App State. Dustin Kearns' team went to the tournament last year, lost Texas Southern. But, hey, tough team out of Sun Belt. Come to me about that matchup on Friday, man.
Yeah, it's going to be another great matchup, you know, and like I said earlier, you know, that's been intentional on our part. I mean, to go get, you know, NCAA tournament teams at the top of respective leagues, and, you know, really challenge ourselves. And Dustin does a great job. They're well coached. They've got a great program. They've been to the tournament, and should be another exciting game. We had an electric crowd in Timmins on Friday night in the College of Charleston game, and hoping that's going to be the same case this Friday coming up. And, you know, it's why we do this, right? You want to play in big games, and you want to play in competitive games. And so we're looking forward to the challenge. Should be a great game. And, you know, we've got to turn the pace here quick and get all our attention on App State.
I just missed you in Nashville. You went to play Belmont. I was in town that weekend because the Titans had a game that weekend. I just missed you because I know you had to play Belmont early on Sunday. It was the Titans game. So I said, man, I couldn't go come over and see you. But I'm trying to make sure I catch you either at Chattanooga or at Mercer. I'm going to try to make sure if the Hawks start playing on one of those days, I'll try to make sure I see you guys either at Chattanooga or Mercer for sure, man.
Yeah, come on over. We'd love to see you. And, you know, let me know. And we'd love to host you.
Yes, sir. Coach, thank you for your time today, and be safe. We'll talk to you real soon, man.
Sounds good. Have a great one.
You too. Bye now.
Bye.